Hi, it's Jenny with the How and Why of Mathematics, and this week I want to go through my favourite questions from the past Australian Mathematics Competition papers. So you can buy these booklets. This is what you would have gotten back sort of 30 years ago. This is what they look like today. And I'll put a link in the description for where you can buy these. But they have great questions in them, really challenging, tricky, really fun ones that need a lot of creativity to solve. And this week I just want to be going through questions from the junior division, which is for students who are about 13 years old. Okay, first question. So we've got a shed that's 9 meters by 7 meters. And there's a goat tethered to the corner of the shed. I'll try to draw a little goat here. He's tied onto the corner there by a rope that's 10 meters long. And the question is, how much grass can the goat graze on? Like, what's the area of the grass that it can reach? And this was from the 1989 competition, and only 5% of students got this one right. So pause the video, give that a go, and then I'll go through the solution. Alright, so the first thing we want to do is try to visualize the area that this goat can reach. So he can go, you know, anywhere within 10 meters. So I'm sort of tracing out this circle that's 10 meters. And then we'll figure out what happens there in a minute. So we want to go 10 meters in every direction. Okay, and then what happens when he reaches here? So he's used 7 meters of his rope to get to there, and then he's got 3 meters left. So if you can imagine him up there, but then he can also reach out here. Anywhere within 3 meters of there he can reach, because he's still got 3 meters of rope. So that's going to make a little quarter circle with a radius of 3 meters. And similar sort of thing over here, where, so he's used 9 meters of his rope to get to here, and then he's got 1 meter left, so he can go around in a little quarter circle with a radius of 1 meter. Okay, so, well, we know the area of a circle is pi times the radius squared. If we've just got a fraction of a circle, like a quarter of a circle, it's just going to be a quarter of that. And this bit is 3/4 of a circle with a radius of 10 meters. So the whole circle with a radius of 10 meters would be pi times 10 squared. But then we just want 3/4 of that. So that is this whole bit here. All right, let's do this bit. That's gonna be pi times, radius is 3 squared, but it's just 1/4 of that. So I'll divide it by 4, because it's just 1/4 circle. And then for this one, the radius is 1 meter. So we've got pi times 1 squared, and again on 4, because it's just 1/4 circle. So we just need to add all these up. That one is gonna make 300 pi on 4, because 10 squared is 100, and then you multiply that by the 3. We could simplify the 300 on 4, but because we're going to be adding it to these ones, which have a 4 on the bottom as well, I'll just leave it like that for now. So that one is 3 squared is 9, 9 pi on 4, and that one's just pi on 4. Now, if you haven't done much algebra, you might be a bit confused about how to add all these with the pi in them. What you could just think of it as is 300 on 4, so that much pi, and then 9 on 4 pi, and then another 1 on 4 pi, so we'll work out what that is, and then just, that's how much pi, basically. So if we add all those up, you can just add the numerators, so that would make 310 over 4. And then we can simplify that because these are both even. So let's divide both of them by 2. That one divided by 2, I would work it out like 150 is half of 300, and then 5 is half of 10, so it's 155. And then we just need to multiply by pi. So the answer would be 155 pi over 2. Okay, next question. We've got 2 jars containing a mixture of water and vinegar. Now the jars are identical, except this one contains a mixture of water and vinegar in the ratio 2:1. And for this second jar, the water and vinegar is in the ratio 3:1. But they both have the same amount of liquid in them. And the question is, if we poured both of these jars into another container, what would be the ratio of water to vinegar in that container? And this is from the 1988 competition, and only 2% of students got this one right. Okay, let's have a look at it. So, with this one, it's much easier to work with fractions rather than ratios. Like, let's try to work out what fraction of this first jar is water and what fraction is vinegar. So if it's 2 parts water to 1 part vinegar, then there's 3 parts in total. So 2 out of 3 of it is water, and 1 out of 3 is vinegar. So it's like we've got 2/3 of a jar of water and 1/3 of a jar of vinegar. In the second jar, we have 4 parts in total, 3 parts of water and 1 part vinegar makes 4 parts. So 3/4 of the jar is water and 1/4 is vinegar. So you can actually kind of think of this as being the amounts of water and vinegar measured in units of 1 jar's worth. So there's 2/3 of a jar's worth. So you could imagine that the jar is 1 liter or 1 gallon or whatever, and that this is 2/3 of 1 liter or whatever, if you want. So let's work out how much water and vinegar is in the final container. So the amount of water, we've got 2/3 of a jar plus 3/4 of a jar. So we just need to add these two fractions. We need to make a common denominator. So we can do just 3 times 4 is 12. And I know this sometimes confuses people about what to multiply by what. You just remember that to make an equivalent fraction, you multiply the top and bottom by the same thing. So we've multiplied the 3 by 4 to get the 12. That means we have to multiply the top by 4 as well. So that's 8. And then when we do the second fraction, we've multiplied the bottom by 3 to make 12, so we've got to multiply the top by 3 as well. And then we just add these up. So 17 over 12, or 17/12 of a jar of water is in the final container. All right, what about the vinegar? We've got the 1/3 of a jar plus 1/4 of a jar. Make the common denominator again, multiply that one by 4, and multiply that one by 3. So we get 7 over 12. So the ratio, remember the question was, what is the ratio of water to vinegar in the final mixture? So we've got 17 over 12 to 7 over 12. And then usually with ratios, what you want to do is simplify that to a whole number. So you can just multiply both of them by 12, just like with fractions, you can multiply top and bottom by 12 and get a similar, an equivalent fraction. So multiply both of those by 12, we get 17:7 is the ratio of water to vinegar in the container. Okay, next question. In this one, we've got 4 points along a straight line, and they're all equally spaced. They each have 1 meter between them. And the question is, how do we get from P to S in the shortest way possible but we have to stay at least 1 meter away from Q and R. So we're not allowed to walk straight through here. We have to go sort of around there somehow. But we want to know the shortest path from P to S. And this one was from the 1988 competition as well, and only 5% of students got this one right. Okay, so let's start by figuring out what is our path going to look like. And what I would do is imagine the area that you're not allowed inside is actually like a circle around Q, because if we're not allowed within 1 meter of Q, then we're not allowed inside here. And same with not being allowed within a meter of R, that's like this. So we have to stay outside of this region. So if we just walked like along the edge of there, that's good. And we'll have to finish up by walking along that edge there. But in between, what do? Well, we wanna go sort of from here to here in the shortest way possible, where we can just go straight there. Straight line is the shortest path between 2 points. And that is just directly above Q, and that's just directly above R, despite my bad drawing. So that means that this will just be a quarter of a circle. So we know the circumference of a circle is 2 pi R. The radius here is 1, so it's just 2 pi. But if we just want to go a quarter of the way around the circle, then it's going to be this divided by 4. So 2 pi r over 4, which is just pi r over 2, if you simplify that. And then since r is 1, it's just pi on 2 is that distance there. And then this bit, remember they're all just 1 meter apart, so there's a meter from q to r, this is going to be the same. So that's 1 meter. And then this will be the same as the pi on 2. So we've got that distance plus that distance plus that distance. That will make 1 plus pi. Okay, last question. So in this one they said that you've got this big rectangle and there's all these squares inside it, and the smallest square has an area of 2 by 2. So its sides are each 2. And we want to know the side length of the next biggest square. Well, with this one you had to read the question quite carefully because it's sort of drawn inaccurately, and they do that on purpose so that you can't just eyeball what it looks like the next square is. Because what they said was that this was actually a rectangle even though it's drawn as a square, so it isn't necessarily square. Like, that's not necessarily the same length as that. And they said that all of these are squares. So even though, you know, this one is very much not drawn as a square, they're saying that that length is the same as that length. Okay. So I'm just going to write a 2 on this one so that we know that the side length is 2. And then because we're trying to work out this side length, I might just call that x, because we don't know what it is yet. But if each of the sides of this is x, so that's x, and that's x, and that's x. Let's have a look at this square, because we've got this side here, we can work that out, because we know that that one's 2, and that one's x. So that's going to be 2 plus x. And then you've got this square here. Remember, these are all squares, so if we know that that's 2 plus x, then this also has to be 2 plus x. And this side's 2. So we've got a 2 and a 2 plus x, so that length there is 4 plus x. And that also means this length here is 4 plus x, even though it doesn't look the same as that one. Okay, what else can we work out? We can look at this square. So we've got that length is 2 plus x, and that one's 4 plus x. So together that's going to make 6, because the 2 plus 4 is 6, and then you've got 2 x's. Right, now we could look at this one. We've got a 6 plus 2x and a 4 plus x. So 6 plus 4 is 10. And then we've got a 2x and an x, that makes 3x. We could also do this one. We've got that length is 6 plus 2x, that one's 2 plus x, and that one's x, so let's add all those up. The 6 and the 2 make 8, and then you've got a 2x, an x, and another x, so that'll be 4x. Okay, we could do this one. We've got the 8 plus 4x and the x, that'll make 8 plus 5x. And then we could also do this one from all of these lengths added up. So a 2 and a 4 plus x and the 10 plus 3x. 2 plus 4 plus 10 makes 16. And then we've got an x and a 3x is 4x. Okay, well, now what we could look at is this length along here. So we could measure it as being the x plus the 8 plus 5x, or we could also work it out from being 2 and 16 plus 4x. Those have to be the same thing. So let's write that down as an equation. We've got the x plus the 8 plus 5x, and that has to equal 2 plus the 16 plus 4x. So that'll give us an equation that we can solve for x. Let's simplify this. We've got an x and a 5x is 6x. The 2 plus the 16 make 18. Now what we could do is move the 4x over to the left, so we subtract 4x from both sides of the equation. That'll give us 2x plus 8 equals 18, and then we could subtract the 8 from both sides to move it across. That'll give us 2x equals 10, and then we can divide by 2. That'll give us x equals 5. So there's the answer.
All right, let me know in the comments what your favorite maths question is. And if you like this video, then subscribe, because I'm planning to make more videos like this in the future.